everybody. This video is an introduction to the cross product, also known as the vector product or outer product. This is another important useful vector operation, which unlike the dot product results in a vector. In this video, we're going to limit our discussion to 3D vectors, though this operation does generalize to higher dimensions. Let's start with a definition. If we start with two vectors, A equal x1, y1, z1, and B equals x2, y2, z2, then the cross product is a new vector given by the definition shown here. This definition does not lend itself to easy memorization. An easier form of this is to use the 2x2 determinant, where, hopefully, you recall, the determinant of a matrix ABCD is just AD minus BC. Now, the components of the cross product can be written as three 2x2 determinants, where the ith component is the determinant of the matrix, ignoring the ith component from vectors A and B. Note that the numbers on the top row of each determinant correspond to the first vector of the cross product and the bottom row to the second vector. Also beware that the second component has a negative in front. Here's a couple of examples. We'll let A equal 0, 1, 2 and B equal 2, negative 3, 1. Then A cross B is the new vector where the first component is the 2x2 determinant ignoring both x values. The second component has a negative in front but skips the y values, and the third component skips the z values. This gives us the new vector 7, 4, negative 2. If we reverse the order and look at B cross A, then the components of B now go in the top row of each determinant, and we get the vector negative 7, negative 4, 2, which is the opposite of A cross B. In general, when we switch two rows of a matrix, the determinant gets the opposite sign. So we can conclude that A cross B will always equal minus B cross A. Two more quick examples. The first is rather obvious, but if we cross a vector with the zero vector, then one row of each determinant will be zero, and the result will necessarily be the zero vector. Perhaps not quite as obvious if we take a vector and cross it with itself, then this will give us the same numbers on the top and bottom of our determinant, which will again give us the zero vector. In fact, whenever two rows of a matrix are the same, the determinant is zero. So A cross A is going to equal the zero vector for any vector A. We can actually extend our determinant idea a bit further by looking at 3x3 determinants. We'll use the method of Laplace to expand about the top row. If the top row is A, B, and C, the second row is vector A, and the third row is vector B, then we get A, B, and C times exactly the same three determinants that occurred in our 2x2 definition. A quick example is shown here, expanding about the top row, 3, 2, and 1, and we get 3 times our first 2x2, the opposite of 2 times our second 2x2, and finally 1 times our third 2x2. If only numbers are involved, we get a scalar. So in this case, we calculate and combine everything to get 0. However, we plan to use this definition in a different way. An alternate way to represent vectors is using component form, where I, j, and k represent unit vectors in the x, y, and z direction, respectively. Using this form, instead of writing x1, y1, and z1 in brackets, we write this as x1i plus y1j plus z1k. Similarly, we could write the vector result of our cross product as the first determinant times I minus the second times j plus the third times k. By using our definition for a 3x3 determinant, this equates to the determinant of the 3x3 matrix with components I, j, and k on the first row, our two vectors a and b for the second and third row. So what are the geometric properties associated with this new vector, A cross B? We'll first consider the direction of A cross B. Consider taking the dot product of A with the vector A cross B. This will be x1, y1, and z1 dotted with our regular definition. But this gives us x1 times the first determinant minus y1 times the second plus z1 times the third, which is again the exact definition of our 3x3 determinant. Notice in the 3x3 format, we again have two rows that are the same, so the determinant must be 0. Since the dot product is 0, this means that A cross B is perpendicular to A. Likewise, B dotted with B cross A will be 0, but B cross A is antiparallel to A cross B, so B is also perpendicular to A cross B. Since A cross B is perpendicular to both A and B, this means that A cross B must be perpendicular to the plane containing vectors A and B. Of course, this gives us two possible directions. It turns out that A cross B follows what's called the right-hand rule. If you use your right hand and let your index finger represent the vector A and your middle finger represent the vector B, then your thumb will be pointing in the direction of A cross B. That is, looking down from the side where A cross B is pointing, vector A must rotate counterclockwise to get to B. If we return to our component form, it's easy to show using our definition that I cross J equals K, J cross K equals I, and K cross I equals J. And this is clearly consistent with the right-hand rule. We also already showed that I cross I equals J cross J equals K cross K equals 0. And along with our anti-commutative property, we can create the table shown here for I, J, and K. Because the distributive property holds for the cross product, we can actually just work directly with vectors in their component form, though generally this is more tedious. In the example below, we find 2i plus j cross I plus 3j minus k. Each term, such as I cross I and j cross k, gives us something we can evaluate from our table, and we eventually end up with minus I plus 2j plus 5k. In fact, we could have started with this table, and we could cross x1i plus y1j plus z1k with x2i plus y2j plus z2k, and derived exactly the formula that we started with for our cross product. Components also give us an easy example to show the cross product is not associative. If we consider I cross j by performing the second cross product first, we get that I cross k equals minus j. However, if we perform the first cross product first, we get the zero vector cross j, which is the zero vector. For our first application of the cross product, we'll use it to find the equation of a plane containing 3 points. In 3D, we need a point on the plane and a vector perpendicular to the plane called the normal. Now, a vector joining any point on the plane with our fixed point must be perpendicular to our normal. So if n is equal to nx, ny, and z, and p0 equals x0, y0, z0 is our fixed point, then all the points p on the plane satisfy p minus p0 dot n is equal to 0. And the equation for our plane is then nx times x minus x0 plus ny times y minus y0 equals nz times z minus z0 equals 0. So suppose we're given 3 points on a plane. We need a point and the normal vector. Well, we have a point. In fact, we have three of them. To get the normal vector, we just create a vector from A to B and a vector from C to A. Then we have two vectors in the plane. Taking the cross product will give us a normal vector perpendicular to the plane. In this example, A equals 2, 3, negative 2, B equals 1, 3, 5, and C is equal to negative 2, 0, negative 4. We let B1 be the vector joining A and B, so this is B minus A equals negative 1, 0, 7. And let B2 be the vector joining C and A, so this is C minus A equals negative 4, negative 3, negative 2. Now our normal vector is just V1 cross V2, which is 21, 33. Plugging the normal N and our point B into the equation above, we get the equation of the plane is 21 times X minus 1 plus 30 times Y minus 3 plus 3 times Z minus 5 equals 0. We're multiplying this out, 21x plus 30y plus 3z equals 126. Now that we know the direction, let's determine the magnitude of A cross B. We'll start with a short lemma that relates the magnitude back to the dot product. It says that the magnitude of A cross B squared is equal to the magnitude of A squared times the magnitude of B squared minus A dot B squared. The proof is shown here, but it's really brute force. We just let A equal x1, y1, z1, and B equal x2, y2, z2, and then plug them in. After a bunch of algebra and rearranging, we get that our right-hand side equals the left-hand side. Now we recall that A dot B is equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the cosine of theta, where theta is the angle between A and B. Plugging this into our result, we get that the magnitude of A cross B squared equals the magnitude of A squared times the magnitude of B squared times 1 minus cosine squared theta, which equals the magnitude of A squared times the magnitude of B squared times sine squared theta. Taking the square root of both sides, we get a result that the magnitude of A cross B is just equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of theta. This has a nice geometric interpretation. Recall that the area of a parallelogram is the base times the height. By letting our vectors A and B correspond to two sides of a parallelogram, we can see that the height is just the magnitude of B times the sine of theta, and the base is just the magnitude of A. So the area of the parallelogram is the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of theta, which is just equal to the magnitude of A cross B. So to summarize, A cross B creates a new vector, which is perpendicular to the plane containing A and B, and has a magnitude equal to the area of the parallelogram with sides A and B. The magnitude of A cross B is also used as a test for parallel vectors. Assuming A and B are not zero vectors, then zero equals the magnitude of A cross B, which equals the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of theta, if and only if the sine of theta is equal to zero, which implies that either theta is zero or 180 degrees, so the vectors are parallel or anti-parallel. This makes sense from our area model. The only way our parallelogram will collapse and have an area of zero is that the vectors A and B are parallel. So checking if the magnitude of A cross B is zero is a quick test to see if two 3D vectors are parallel. As a final example, let's find the distance between two 3D lines. Lines are usually specified in 3D parametrically. Given a point P and a vector D pointing in the direction of the line, then the line has the equation L of T equals P plus T times D, where T is our parameter. Suppose we have the line going through 1, 2, negative 1 in the direction 3, 1, negative 2, and the line going through 0, 2, 1 going in the direction 4, 0, 1. Parametrically, our first line becomes x equals 1 plus 3t, y equals 2 plus t, and z equals negative 1 minus 2t. Our second line becomes x equals 4s, y equals 2, and z equals 1 plus s. The lines do not intersect in 3D, but we can find the shortest distance between them. It should be fairly obvious that the segment connecting our two closest points must be perpendicular to both of our lines. This means that it's perpendicular to both our direction vectors, and hence must be in the direction d1 cross d2, which is 1, negative 11, negative 4. So let's call this vector n. Now choose a point on each line and create a vector v joining them. Viewing from a direction perpendicular to n, we can see that our distance can be found by projecting v onto n. For example, let's let b equal p1 minus p2, the vector joining the two points that define our lines. So v is now equal to 1, 0, 2. The length of the projection of v onto n will just be v dot n over the magnitude of n. In this case, that equals 9 over the square root of 138, or about 0.7661. So let's wrap things up by doing a quick comparison between the cross and dot products. They're quite different, but easily confused. The cross product will give us a vector, while the dot product results in a scalar. The direction of the cross product is normal to the plane containing both vectors, and its magnitude is equal to the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the sine of theta. The dot product equals the length of the projection times the length of what you project onto, and the value is going to be the magnitude of A times the magnitude of B times the cosine of theta. The dot product is commutative, while the cross product is anti-commutative, but both operations preserve the distributive property of over vector addition. So hopefully this will get you started on working with a cross product. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching.